Sold. Okay. Jai Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari. Jai Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari. Gopi Janavallava Kiri Varadhari. Gopi Janavallava Kiri Varadhari. Yasoda Nandana Raja Janahanjaya. Yasoda Nandana Raja Janahanjaya. Jamuna Tirahavana Jahadi Jamuna. Jamuna Tirahavana Jahadi Jamuna. Jai Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari. Hare Krishna. Hey, Giri Bharat, Vishwoda Nandanda, Gaja Janahanja. Hey, Ashwoda Nandanda, Gaja Janahanja. Hey, Gaja Janahanja, Jamuna Tira, Hulvani.
Gaur Premanande Hari Hari Om Jai Om Vishnupad Paramahans Parivajakacharya Stotra Satishri Shriman His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. ISKCON Founder Acharya, His Divine Grace, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Raj Granth Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai. Sri Harinam Sankirtan Ki Jai. Sri Sri Kishore Kishari Ki Jai. Jagannath Baladev Subhadra Maharani Ki Jai. Sri Sri Gornitai Ki Jai. Harinam Sankirtan Ki Jai. Hare Krishna Mahamantra Ki Jai. Gaur Premanande. Glories to the assembled devotees, all glories to the assembled devotees, all glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Chapter, Canto 6, Chapter 7. Indra offends Brihaspati. This is text number 16 through 21. Evam chintayastasya. Magono Bhagavan Grihan Brihaspatir Gato Drishtam Katim Adhyatma Mayaya Evam Chintayastasya Magono Bhagavan Grihatam Brihaspatir Gatam Dristam Gatim Adhyatma Mayaya Evam Chintayastasya Magono Bhagavan Grihat Brihaspatir Gato Dristam Gatim Adhyatma Mayaya
Yeah.
Anyone else? Any of the men? As a matter of etiquette, the ladies should not chant unless they're called on to chant. So we wait till all the men finished, then we ask the ladies to chant. That's the etiquette. Okay. Translation. No, that's not the right verse. Okay. Evam thus chintaya, while thinking very seriously, tasya hi mahogana Indra Bhagavan, the most powerful, grihat, from his home, Brihaspati, Gata, went, Adristam, invisible, Gatim, to a state, Adhyatma, due to being very highly elevated in spiritual consciousness, Mayaya, by his potency. Translation. While Indra, the king of the demigods, thought in this way and repented in his own assembly, Brihaspati, the most powerful spiritual master, understood his mind. Thus he became invisible to Indra and left home, for Brihaspati was spiritually more powerful than King Indra. Please repeat. While Indra, the king of the demigods, thought in this way and repented in his own assembly, Brihaspati, the most powerful spiritual master, understood his mind. Thus he became invisible to Indra and left home. For Brihaspati was spiritually more powerful than King Indra. Okay, next verse. Although Indra searched vigorously within the assistance of other demigods, he could not find Brihaspati. Then Indra thought, alas, my spiritual master has become dissatisfied with me, and now I have no means of achieving good fortune. Although Indra was surrounded by demigods, he could not find any peace of mind. Very important part. Hearing of the pitiable condition of King Indra, the demons, following the instructions of their guru, Sukracharya, equipped themselves with weapons and declared war against the demigods. The demigods' heads, thighs, and arms, and other parts of their bodies were injured by the sharp arrows of the demons. The demigods, headed by Indra, saw no other course than to immediately approach Lord Brahma with bowed heads for shelter and proper instructions. Text 20. When the most powerful Lord Brahma saw the demigods coming towards him, their bodies gravely injured by the arrows of the demons, he pacified them by his great causeless mercy and spoke as follows. Translation purport by his divine grace. Lord Brahma said, O best of the demigods, unfortunately, because of madness resulting from your material opulence, you failed to receive Brihaspati properly when he came to your assembly. Because he is aware of the Supreme Brahman and in full control of his senses, he is the best of the Brahmanas. Therefore, it is very astonishing that you have acted impudently towards him. Prabhupada's purport. Lord Brahma recognized the brahminical qualifications of Brihaspati, who was the spiritual master of the demigods because of his awareness of the Supreme Brahman. Brihaspati was very much in control of his senses and mind, and therefore he was a most qualified Brahmana.
Lord Brahma chastised the demigods for not properly respecting this Brahmana, who was their guru. Lord Brahma wanted to impress upon the demigods that one's guru should not be disrespected under any circumstances. When Brihaspati entered the assembly of the demigods, they and their king Indra took him for granted. Since he had come every day, they thought they didn't need to show him any special respect. As it is said, familiarity breeds contempt. Being very much displeased, Brihaspati immediately left Indra's palace. Thus, all the demigods headed by Indra became offenders at the lotus feet of Brihaspati. And Lord Brahma, being aware of this, condemned their neglect. In a song we sing every day, Narottam Das Thakur sings, Chaturdan Diloye Janmi Janmi Prabhushe. The guru gives spiritual insight to the disciple, and therefore the guru can be considered his master, life after life. Under no circumstances should the guru be disrespected, but the demigods, being puffed up by their material possessions, were disrespectful to their guru. Therefore, Srimad Bhagavatam 11.17.27 advises, Acharyamam vijaniyam navamanyeta karhichit namartya buddhya suyeta. The acharya should always be offered respectful obeisances. One should never envy the acharya, considering him to be an ordinary human being. Om Agyan Timidandasya Gena Jena Salakaya Chaksu Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Sri Chaitanya Mano Bistam Stabditam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadam Mayam Dadanti Swam Padanti Kam Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. So this section is very instructive. It's one of the most important chapters in the sixth canto, actually in the Bhagavatam, because it actually leads up to a very amazing pastime that's coming up. And we might say that what we have here is the basis of success, the basis of failure. Respect, honor, submission, inquiry, and even glorification of the Supreme Personality of Godhead manifests itself on a day-to-day basis also with his representative, the spiritual master. Why is the spiritual master so much respected? Because he is considered to be the manifestation of Krishna to teach service to Krishna. Krishna teaches himself service to himself by manifesting himself as the pure devotee. Therefore, it says that the Supreme Personality of Godhead manifests himself as the Supreme Lord and the spiritual master who teaches that same process of worshiping the Lord by teaching the same worship towards himself. You know, Prabhupada, sometimes we would see Srila Prabhupada become very strict about discretions and etiquette with his disciples towards himself. Now, an outsider may mistakenly think, well, he's proud, he wants respect. He's proud, he wants respect. And others may, you know, criticize. But actually, unless the disciple learns the principle of submission to the end, honor to the spiritual master, there's no question of any advancement in spiritual life. Nothing. Actually, your spiritual life stops dead right there. Because it is such a fundamental principle that without understanding this deep enough, and those who understand it deeply and have regard for the spiritual master as they would regard the Supreme Lord, they make fast advancement. They make very quick advancement. Why? Because the Supreme Lord has manifested himself in that form to accept service on behalf of his pure devotee. Okay. So we see here an interesting thing. Pride. Pride can come in different ways. Pride can come by having certain qualifications and characteristics, such as good intelligence, ability to memorize and chant slokas and verses, a good birth and a good family, some material opulences, or even good bodily features. These are elements of pride. It's mentioned in the scriptures, actually. These are also gifts that one may receive upon having pious activities in previous lives. Therefore, these boons that one is given can either be an asset or a derailment on the path of spiritual life. And in many cases, unless people are properly instructed, it turns to be obstacles rather than advancements. Indra, look at his position. My God. He's got such power. He's got such facility. And he has such resources. He's the king of heaven. He has all the demigods under his control. They say there's 33 million demigods. That means there's 33 million demigoddesses, which also means that 33 million is a number that is simply given to let us know that there's unlimited demigods. That's why that number is there. It's not a fixed number. It's simply a way of saying it's unlimited. So what such influence, power. Now, in order for him to maintain his position and facilities, he also receives worship. Because those under him respect him and just like the spirit, their spiritual master. Although he's not the spiritual master of the demigods, he's very, very powerful. He's a controller. And he has a spiritual master called Brihaspati. So he was being worshipped in an assembly. You hear that description at the beginning of this chapter. It's amazing. What was going on? The Siddhas, the Charnas, the Vishvadevas, all the major demigods were there singing his glories, fanning him with charmer fans and peacock fans, and chanting his glories, offering him gifts. His wife was sitting next to him on the same sea. He was under a beautiful white umbrella. This is going on. Imagine the scene. Such glory he's receiving. It's a lot of enthusiasm was being done. In walks his spiritual master in the middle of it. He sees his spiritual master. He doesn't do anything. Because it says when one spiritual master walks into one's assembly, one should immediately worship him in terms of at least offering, acknowledging his presence and offering him respect. Just like sometimes we are worshiping the deity on the altar during arti. If one spiritual master walks in, it's not an offense to pay your obeisances to your spiritual master during that worship, although you're worshiping the Supreme Lord. For those who that person is not the spiritual master, they may choose to do it or may not to. But for one who is actually their spiritual master, that is considered to be correct etiquette. Because this Krishna sees that his representative is more important than he is. That's how Krishna sees. So that's the vision we try to adopt. So when Brihaspati came into the assembly, Indra didn't do anything. And they saw him too. As it says here, he was coming every day. I know, we see him every day, right? So we kind of here he comes again, right on time. And so they had lost, of course, the mood and the worship was so powerful And Indra didn't think it was necessary. But Brihaspati noted there was an element of pride in Indra. And therefore, he immediately left to smash that pride. But that discretion, which was a major offense actually, became such a result in action that the demigods lost all their power and the demons took advantage of it and start chastising the demigods heavenly. It says, Mukam karoti vacha lampung langa purgade kirim, what is that? Yat kripa tanaham bande shigurun dinatarinum. By the mercy of the spiritual master, one can do the impossible. The impossible becomes possible with the mercy of the spiritual master. Not by one's abilities or intelligence or previous successes does one become successful. Therefore, one should hold tightly to the spiritual master's lotus feet as the only source of one's advancement in spiritual life and success in everything. This is the essence of Krishna conscious practice. And that pride, that element of pride, when it comes in, it sort of blurs one's vision and one cannot see things correctly. And therefore, when Brihaspati turned and left, Indra somehow immediately knew he made a mistake. Brihaspati wanted to teach a lesson. Oh, you're proud. Okay, so therefore I'm going. And then it says in those verses, he looked everywhere. Adrishtam, the word adrishtam is mentioned. Brihaspati became invisible. Couldn't find him anywhere. He wanted to go and apologize. Brihaspati didn't want that. He wanted to teach him a lesson. Oh, you rascal. Okay, now you have to suffer with your offense. Imagine how Indra felt. He felt really, really low. He was really feeling bad. He knew he made a mistake, and the other devas also understood. But it was too late. The estate was as was given. Now, you might think, well, if he could just find his spiritual master and somehow apologize, it would be okay. Even if he did, it wouldn't be the same. It's like if you hit a nail into a piece of wood, and then you take the nail out, still there's a hole there. Still there's a hole there. So there's some effect from the offense, even though one may apologize and humbly, effect for the offense. So Brihaspati wanted to teach a lesson. And this really led to a whole series of, you'll read it, it's this section of the Bhagavatam is so wonderful. Study this chapter. On a personal level, this chapter we teach in Mayapur every year as part of Bhakti Vai Bhava, this particular chapter. Now, how did Indra somehow or other act in that way? Again, success, pride. When one gets a little proud, for whatever reason, one fails to act in the proper way. Pride blurs one's consciousness. Others can see it, but the person who has it doesn't see it so easily. So having such power, influence, and followers blurred his vision, and he could not somehow or other respect his spiritual master. And as Prabhupada says, you know, this is not a small offense, it's a big and great offense. So in the previous verse, I don't know who gave class yesterday? You did. When I heard the verse, I was thinking I missed the best verse by one clue. I was thinking, oh, number 15. This is the essence of all verses. This verse, I'd like to read it again. Number 15 in this chapter says, therefore, with great frankness and without duplicity, I shall now bow my head at the lotus feet of Brihaspati, the spiritual master of the demigods, because he is in the mode of goodness. He is fully aware of knowledge and is the best of the brahmanas. Now I shall touch his lotus feet and offer my obeisances to try to satisfy him. Prabhupada, in the purport, explains five ways one becomes offending to the spiritual master. Or we might say, five ways you can disrespect the spiritual master. Hypocrisy, duplicity, familiarity, unfaithfulness, and disobedience. These are the five ways. Hypocrisy, duplicity, unfaithfulness, disobedience, and familiarity. Prabhupada mentions in this particular one, familiarity. Sometimes the spiritual master will become very friendly with his disciples because it's the nature of a nature of a devotee is that he sometimes takes that position of becoming friend. But if the disciple somehow or other uses that friendliness to become familiar, then one will commit an offense like that. We see in the life of Srila Prabhupada, he had many personal servants. And some lasted longer than others. But in each case, we see that sometimes they were relieved from their personal service because they were getting too familiar. You're with the spiritual master all day. You're seeing certain activities and you start thinking in an ordinary way. He's liking me. You know. And then if you think that way, then you minimize his position and then you lose that element of respect. So therefore, one should always cultivate that mood of humility and respect to the spiritual master and never lose it. Because by losing that, one loses one's spiritual advancement fast. So Indra, I mean, he might say it happened so fast. Brihaspati walked in, saw the worship, Indra looked at him and just went back to the worship. Brihaspati just noted his... It was so quick. It was so fast. It wasn't like a long played out, you know, discretion. It just happened so fast. He was so much in the mood of that. So one should be very, very aware of this thing. Therefore, one of the things is pranipat. Pranipat. Pranipat means obeisances. One should be eager to offer obeisances to one's spiritual master. And one should pray to the spiritual master for mercy. One should submit himself in front of the spiritual master and tell the spiritual master just how fallen they are. This is good practice. These are etiquettes. These are ways that help one to open one's heart in the proper way. This is very good. We might think, well, it's like some kind of false, you know, eulogy. No. It's actually good, because if one not only feels unqualified, but expresses that unqualifiedness in front of the spiritual master, the mercy of the spiritual master, which is Krishna's mercy, flows nicely into the mind and heart of the disciple. So this etiquette is so important. And if you talk to those who really have a deep understanding of Krishna consciousness, I'm sure many of you do, they'll explain to you there is no greater success in spiritual life than to glorify and serve the spiritual master. Some people say, I don't know Krishna. All I know is my guru. And that is the proper mood, right? And the spiritual master never thinks himself to be worthy of what is being given, but still he has the position of accepting it on behalf of Krishna. Therefore, he is called the, as Prabhupada said, what is the word? Something peon. Postal peon. He's receiving the letter. He's just an ordinary letter carrier. He takes your letter, he brings it to the person who's supposed to receive it. That's all. But still, if you disrespect the carrier, the letter will probably not get there. For sure. Even if you have the proper postage. So, therefore one... Just like there was an example. I'll give you a Prabhupada example. Prabhupada, in the very early days, sometimes the spiritual master wants to teach something to the disciple aside from the principle of proper execution of a service. Sometimes the devotee gets so much caught up in the proper execution of the service and doesn't really focus on the etiquette behind the relationship, in relationship to the spiritual master. Example. Prabhupada wanted to send some cassette tapes by post to, I think it was to Satsarupa Maharaj, who was transcribing these tapes. So he wrapped them, gave them to one devotee to put them in the mailbox. The devotee looked at the wrapping after he had walked away from Prabhupada and said, came back to Prabhupada and said, Srila Prabhupada, it was actually Swamiji at the time. Swamiji, this is not properly wrapped. I don't think it'll go through the postal system. Prabhupada said, just send it. It's okay. Now, the man acted correctly there. And he's walking away, and he's thinking, I don't think Prabhupada understands how the postal system in America works. Anyway, I'll go back and ask him again. So he's brought it back and said the same thing. And Prabhupada said, no, it's all right. It'll just send it. It'll go. So, he reluctantly walks away, and he's thinking, maybe I should make my point a little stronger. Prabhupada doesn't really understand. So he came back and again made his point. This time Prabhupada became angry. He said, everything the spiritual master does is correct. Mail it. He got the point. He was teaching a certain principle to that person. The man made the right statement on the first time by saying, oh, maybe. But after hearing, he should have just followed it. But Prabhupada wanted to show that unless you understand obedience to the spiritual master, it's not so important about the service. That's more important, the obedience. So sometimes that we find that there. So therefore, that's why Prabhupada used to say, my spiritual master is wrong, but he's right. Now, can we digest that one? Or is it still stuck in the throat? You need some water? How about some Alka-Seltzer? That's a tough one, right? He's wrong, but he's right. The example, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, 1930. Devotees had just got a new building in Bagh Bazar in Calcutta. And it was a, marble building. It was a couple floors. And all of a sudden, there was some turmoil. And everybody was running around. There's a snake that had climbed all the way up to the second floor. Snake, snake, snake. And everybody was worried. So they were doing whatever they could. And Bhaktisiddhanta came out and said, kill the snake. So some devotee came and killed the snake. Now, Srila Prabhupada, our spiritual master, was thinking, how is it possible that a saintly person can order killing of a living entity? He didn't question beyond his mind, but he did question in his mind. But he didn't say anything out loud. And then later on, he was reading the seventh canto, where it says that, saintly persons take great happiness in scorpions and snakes being killed. Of course, we don't go around killing such things. But if they do happen, it's not a sin. So there, and then Prabhupada said, oh, then I understood. My spiritual master appears to be wrong, but he's right. Like that. So therefore, to correct the spiritual master, that's another thing. One shouldn't correct. One should remain silent. So these are ways, especially from brahmacharis. To brahmacharis, correct the spiritual master. Even if they have a good point, still, it's an offense. So this is the etiquette. It's hard to understand, right? But this, unless we learn unalloyed devotion to Krishna by unalloyed devotion to the spiritual master, and we accept the spiritual master as the example was that in 1966, Prabhupada was giving a lecture. He had just finished giving initiation, and he gave a talk. And the last thing he said, and one should worship the spiritual master as God, and he left. And now everyone was shocked. He's saying, you know, anyone who says he's God is dog, right? G-O-D-D-O-G, right? Now he's saying he's God. So it was really, really confusing. These were all new people who had been in the movement less than 1 year. And now he's saying something else. But one devotee who was very sharp said, no, he's not saying he's God. We should see him like that. We should see him like that. So that's the way a disciple sees the spiritual master. Now you might say, well, that's for Prabhupada. But other, my spiritual master, he may not be on that level. Still, if you somehow minimize the position of the spiritual master, you will not make any advancement. Because the spiritual master is empowered by the Lord to do the service that he's doing. It's not his power, it's Krishna's power. That's all. When we understand that, then we can understand how to relate to all living entities according to the proper etiquette like that. Very difficult for the Western mentality. For those who are brought up in India, it's very easy to understand these things because this is the culture is taught like that from the very time you were born. But in Western culture, nobody respects anybody. Right? Just the way it is. We even lose respect for our friends, for our parents. There's no respect like that. So this is a society that, as Prabhupada said, very dysfunctional. Therefore, when Prabhupada was teaching Krishna consciousness to his new disciples, it was difficult. It was difficult. Because they couldn't understand the etiquette. It was very, very difficult. So this is fundamental. To receive knowledge, transmission of knowledge comes by submission and not by qualification. Qualification may be an adjunct or a decoration on the submission, but it's not the point. Therefore, one can be the greatest learned scholar simply by being submissive to the spiritual master. That's all. Because the spiritual master, when he sees a disciple being very submissive and enthusiastic in their service, he blesses that spiritual master, that disciple, with Krishna's mercy. And then that is the success of one's endeavor. We should never lose that. In the beginning, we may remember that, and then after we practice Krishna consciousness for a while, we tend to somehow lose that understanding. But if we lose that understanding, we lose our connection with Krishna. We lose our connection with Krishna. So this is very important to understand. So remember those five, what we say, disqualifications. Hypocrisy, duplicity, familiarity, disobedience, and unfaithfulness. That's mentioned in that verse. If you can read that verse 15, you'll find those five things are in that translation. Prabhupada mentions it in the purport in detail like that. Okay, so questions. Yes, Jai Jagannath Prabhu.
I'm wondering if there's some prudence and making the distinction between the stage of accepting the spiritual master and the stage of getting initiated from him and then receiving knowledge. Because in the Bhaktirasamrita Sindhu, we hear the first.
Yeah.
And the reason I'm asking that is in this context, one thing that I've observed in ISKCON is that devotees get initiated pretty fast, oftentimes, without oftentimes giving themselves enough time to really question the actual basis of their faith in guru, and so on. And as a result, they take initiation quickly. And then later on, they hear a class like yours, which speaks of these sort of deeper level convictions in guru. Mm-hmm. And because they haven't given themselves time to actually process what it really means to accept a guru and so on, they take initiation, and thereafter, they start to be plagued with all these doubts hearing messages as this. So yeah. I was wondering if there's
or
some prudence.
Or if they receive an instruction and it's too hard to carry out, they don't do it.
Yeah, because they don't really have that faith, and they didn't give themselves enough time to examine. And I know Prabhupada has often spoke of the principle of 1 year that a spiritual master should observe the disciple and vice versa. And something that I don't know is very much practiced in a very serious way within our movement. So I'm wondering, because I often do advise in this way, so I guess I'm asking a question about that even when devotees feel that they have found their gurus and so on, is it prudent to tell them to like kind of wait to really examine what is the actual basis of their convictions and so on before making such decisions? Because if they start having doubts after they get initiated, then it becomes very dangerous in terms of their spiritual development.
You made so many good points for the reason why we should do what we say full examination and proper understanding. All your points are excellent. And it goes back to the statements in the Hari Bhakti Vilas. Because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told Sanatana Goswami to write this down. And that's part of the Hari Bhakti Vilas. It's called mutual observation. The spiritual master sees if the devotee and disciple is qualified. He examines him or her. And the disciple watches and looks at the spiritual master in the same way. So this is called mutual, Prabhupada's, what do you say, what's Prabhupada's word? Mutual testing. So, but once you take the initiation, the test is over. It's another kind of test. So you can still escape now. If you want. This is Bhakti Tirtha Maharaj. I was at an initiation ceremony, and he was just sitting down. He said, "All right, any of you want to change your mind right now before it's too late?" So at that point, that's the last time. Before then, take your time and be sure, because it says if you disobey the orders of the spiritual master, you know, that is considered an offense to the holy name. And therefore, you would not be able to properly chant the holy names of the Lord. Therefore, even though Hari Bhakti Vilas mentions it and Srila Prabhupada says 1 year minimum, we see in our Krishna consciousness society that our spiritual masters are making devotees a little bit longer than 1 year, at least in some cases. And that is good, because that builds that faith, and that faith has to be there, because if you disobey the orders of the spiritual master or you break the regulative principles after you get initiation, it's not the same as if you were to do it before. If you do it before, there's a slight, when we say, dip in your advancement. But if you do it after, then you're going to get a pretty heavy reaction. And you may also find yourself, you know, struggling to get back to where you were. So it's a serious thing. Therefore, one should very carefully, like I say, when you take a spiritual master, it's not like buying a new pair of shoes. It's more like buying a house. You have to take your time and see if this is the exact thing you want to live in for the rest of your life. Or you might say, even more serious about it, it's not like getting married. When you get married, you're very careful to make sure that that partner is going to be a lifetime affair. At least that's the idea. I mean, now in Kali Yuga, it's just like, well, we'll trade this one in and get a new one. This one looks better than the old one. The old one's wearing out anyway. Oh, it's really, I don't want to get on this one because it's just, Anyway, so it's a serious thing. I was in the Ukraine, and I was one girl, she waited 11 years. We don't recommend you wait that long, but she was willing to wait 11 years, even because of the way things played itself out. The idea is that when the spiritual master gives that statement, do you agree to follow, and, you know, 16 rounds like that, it's not a small thing. It's a vow. So, and that means to obey the spiritual master's instructions. You may question the instructions for clarification, and you may also question the instructions for practical understanding or how to best execute it. And you may also question, well, maybe could you give me a different instruction? And if the spiritual master does, then that's fine. But in any case, whatever instruction you do receive as the final, one has to carry it out. And there's two kinds of instructions. There's the general ones that we follow. Chant 16 rounds, follow the four regulative principles. These are the 64 regulative principles that are mentioned in Nectar of Devotion. And then there's the day-to-day instructions you may receive as an individual from your spiritual master. Both are important. And both, one should not minimize, you know, instructions like that. So your point is well made, yeah. Sometimes we do rush into giving initiations. Therefore, it says a spiritual master should not be eager to have followers. He should do it only as a service. He doesn't collect disciples to see how many he can have or have a big Vyasa Puja. You know? It's not the program. Because, you know, and then sometimes we look, oh, that one's a rich one. I got to have one, that one from my design. I can drive around in a Rolls Royce at his expense, you know. And then that guru is fallen. He becomes fallen. He's no longer able to do any, what we say, real guiding anymore. Yes.
Kind of a follow-up. You were mentioning about one Mataji who waited 11 years. Sometimes I wonder, because when we look at some of our acharyas historically, they didn't take initiation until much later in their life, in many cases. You know, our Srila Prabhupada was 33, I think, when he took initiation from Srila Bhaktisiddhanta.
Yeah, it was actually at least 10 years after he met him.
And I'm also remembering Srila Gaura Govinda Maharaj, who took initiation when he was like 44 or something, from Srila Prabhupada. And so and even Srila Bhaktisiddhanta. So I'm seeing like these examples of personalities in our movement who.
It's a serious thing. It's a serious thing. It's not just you enter into a club and get a name and you're cool now.
Right, so that's where my question is.
That's not the whole program, you know. People think like that. Well, I want to join the Hare Krishnas. I get a cool name and I can wear that funny looking thing they wear. No, it's not like that. This is serious. This is serious business. One should carefully follow the process. One should be serious about one's spiritual life and do what is properly needed in order to make advancement. But the fundamental principle is obedience. That's the fundamental principle. As Prabhupada said, disciple means discipline. Disciple means discipline. It comes from the same word. But nowadays, people don't want to be disciplined. They want to surrender up to a certain point. And that means they make advancement up that far and they can't make any more advancement. So a spiritual master is like a kind father. He's not like going to give you a hard time. He's going to gradually take you from where you are to the next stage, according to how best you, just like when you lead a child to walk, you don't push him or make him run. You take him one step at a time until he can start picking up his own speed. So that's the nature of a spiritual master. He doesn't try to, you know, all of a sudden push his disciple into pure devotional activity. Although he teaches pure devotional service, he encourages them to make advancement where they are, like that. You know, Krishna is very difficult to approach. Very difficult. Therefore, the spiritual master is considered to be the mercy manifestation of Krishna. Therefore, that's why worship of the spiritual master is considered to be higher than worship of Krishna. It's considered by Krishna to be higher than worship himself. So, yeah, therefore, one should be very serious, but one should not be discouraged in the process of devotionalism. Oh, it's too difficult. It's not too difficult. By the mercy of Krishna coming through the spiritual master, it becomes natural. If you are good at getting mercy, that's the whole thing. You have to learn how to be a good mercy beggar. This is the key. I finally got it to it. You have to learn to beg for mercy. If you're good at that and you know how to receive that mercy after you beg it, you are fixed in your spiritual life. And that's what it means to make advancement, to be a good mercy beggar, looking for the mercy. Okay, does that help? You want to add anything?
Which maybe just complete my thought. I was thinking these personalities were so much learned in the scriptures. They grew up in the culture. They had all of these.
I see your point.
And we come from the, especially in the Western world, we have none of that. And we're taking initiation at such a young age. And we may kind of delude ourselves that we're really serious, but later on we come to find ourselves fuzzy. So that's kind of where I'm coming from. Like, how long is a proper time for waiting?
We're just ironing that out in the society where we're now. We have a process to get initiated. The process is, in fact, now the GBC just this year tightened the principles or the requirements for initiation. It's become a lot harder now, basically on the same points you're making. So now it says that in order to get second initiation, you have to be bhakti by bhakti shastra. You have to have bhakti shastra. It's a requirement. It starts next September officially, but it was this year's GBC resolution. They have increased the number of questions for the first initiation now. So on the local level, one needs to work under the guidance of someone who they can take shelter of, who is representing their spiritual master where they are. I tell it to all my disciples, you can't make advancement simply by having a relationship with me. You have to find an elder brother or a guide where you are. Otherwise, how do I know how you're doing? You might write me a letter, but that's not enough. You have to work, and therefore it's required, at least, you know, it should be required, it's almost required in many places, that you receive recommendation from either the temple president who takes the responsibility, or a system of mentors who are giving guidance to people who are taking shelter of spiritual masters, like that. This is the actual system that works, yes. Nityananda Pran. You're next. Nityananda Pran first. Okay, does that point, do you understand this point? That you were making this point that we don't really, but now we have to see what it means to actually make advancement. Oh, I want a guru. Okay, he's my guru, he's accepted me. Now I don't have any other responsibility to anybody else. No. No, it's not going to work. If the spiritual master stays in your area all the time, then we might say that's sufficient. But he doesn't. So it doesn't. You have to have daily guidance and what we say, engagement also. Service and guidance, both. Because the real key to becoming qualified as a devotee is to see how enthusiastic you are to serve. That's the key. The spiritual master will note that this person likes to serve. They're enthusiastic to serve. They want to carry out the instructions. They not only do that, they look for opportunities to serve. That's what the spiritual master looks for. Not so much how much he knows of Shastra. Of course, that's important also. But not as important as the service attitude. Service attitude is the foremost. Yes, Nityananda Prabhu.
If you will allow, just continuing on the same theme. In the Nectar of Devotion, we were reading recently that one should not accept unfit disciples. And Prabhupada writes in that a sannyasi, according to Vedic standards, should not accept anyone who is unfit. And then he says that in the line of Lord Chaitanya, sometimes that's not followed because propagation of Krishna consciousness is important. And by the mercy of the spiritual master and Lord Chaitanya, the unfit is made fit.
Right.
There are two dimensions to, we're talking initiation here particularly. One is the institutional requirement. 1 year of waiting, 1 year of taking shelter, chanting 16 rounds, following regulative principles. So by those standards, most people make it. Because
yeah. They
do. Then there is the other one. The other dimensional is the heart one. Where the heart is, because someone can follow all these very mechanically and check off on their checklist all the things that they're done to be ready for initiation. The heart is someone, like you were mentioning, someone who stays close to them on a regular daily basis. They can sense a whole different thing that an institutional sheet or a checklist cannot.
Right.
So in some cases, to encourage someone to become more enthusiastic, an initiation may be given. In some cases, to discourage pride, it may be held back. In some cases, to develop a deeper understanding of the guru-disciple relationship, some time may be necessary, etc.
Right.
So it's on a one-on-one basis.
Mm-hmm.
In general, we were discussing this earlier, erring on the side of giving more time is far better.
Right.
Because this is a lifelong relationship. It's not a fashion, like you said. It's not a pair of shoes. You got them and you say, I don't like them. We can't return them back. This is a lifelong commitment.
Mm-hmm.
And then, so erring on the side of being a little watchful and waiting is far more beneficial. The taste is sweeter. But sometimes it can be done earlier. It happens a little quicker. Just for encouragement, someone may be angry. So it's a very individualized.
Yeah, the aspiring disciples should not lose enthusiasm because they have to wait.
Yeah.
If they do, they don't understand what it means to go deeper or to access more faith or more enthusiasm in their Krishna consciousness. Mostly it's based on faith. I mean, I saw an example where one very wonderful Sankirtan lady, she came to me, she said, I want a different spiritual master. Now, the one she had was really a very prominent spiritual master in our movement who was always in good standing and still is. She didn't want him, she wanted somebody else. She got fascinated by this other person. No, I told her, you can't do this. I mean, I didn't tell her, I really told her. But she listened but didn't follow. And then she made communication with her spiritual master. And I communicated with him just to find out what was his feeling, and he didn't want to speak about it. He was kind of, overwhelmed with unhappiness. Because, the relationship between a guru and a disciple is like with a girl, it's like father and daughter, and with a boy, it's like father and son. That's the relationship. So it kind of hurts the heart when the spiritual master loses a disciple or sees a disciple losing their own enthusiasm. So he didn't want to talk about it. So she went ahead and went to this other person who was a spiritual master. Now, he made the mistake of accepting her, which he shouldn't have. He should have just pushed her back, but he didn't. And then she got initiated by him. And not long after that, he fell down, the one she took initiation from, the second one. And then she was nowhere. She came running to me. What am I going to do? I said, you got to go back to your original guru. I just offended him so bad. How can I even do that? I said, that's the only recourse. Somehow you're going to have to find the submission in your heart to just apologize and just fall at his feet and beg his forgiveness. And I'm sure he's very compassionate and everything will be, you know, fine. And she did. And he accepted her back. She became in good standing. She thanked me. And then she went on in her devotional service. But this is an example how she somehow lost faith and found more faith, or apparently directed her energy towards someone else. You can't do that. Once you accept a spiritual master, it's for life. Even if the spiritual master leaves the planet, that's still your spiritual master. You may take shiksha guidance from another person, and that's recommended. But still, one cannot get reinitiated for any reason if the spiritual master is still in good standing or has left the planet in good standing like that. I can tell you many examples, you know, of situations that I've been in. So it's a matter of taking enough time to build that faith. And that's the point Jai Jagannath was making. And as you said, the organizational people follow, but the day-to-day, you know, stuff, it's a test. And that test is necessary and good because it brings out the real quality of the devotee. Thank you. Yes. Yeah. I hope this point's clear, not that we just go through these points. Remember what we just discussed, because it's very fundamental to your spiritual practice. Yes.
Thank you for class, Maharaj. I guess the question in my mind is, I never quite understood how one could choose, in a sense, choose the wrong guru. And I went through a bit of a process, but if a guru is in good standing, and
a disciple might be inspired by someone else, and they can take shiksha with the approval of their diksha guru. It happened to me. One disciple came up to me and said, I want to take shiksha from this person. And I know that person now is going to be his prominent guru. And I said, fine. He's not rejecting me, but he wants to get work under the guidance of this other spiritual master who I know is very qualified and will do and will not, you know, interfere with my relationship with my spiritual master. He'll just be someone who will enhance that. So that happens. That a disciple may say, can I take shiksha from... And that shiksha sometimes can be that person's prominent spiritual master, in the sense that they may take more guidance from them. But that shiksha acceptance must first be approved by one's diksha guru. Can't do it arbitrarily. I mean, if some people say to me, Maharaj, I would like to take this person for shiksha, I would say no.
There's certain spiritual masters I wouldn't allow my disciples to take shiksha from, and there's certain ones I would, because our moods are different. So, you know, those who have the same mood, then I would, it's there. Those who have different moods, I would say no. Because once the moods clash, then the instructions can also be like that. So that's okay, as long as it's approved by the spiritual master. But you can't reject in the name of, you know, taking shelter somewhere else. I mean, you look at Bhaktivinoda Thakur. What was his spirit? Who's his spiritual master? Jai Jagannath, who's the spiritual master of Bhaktivinoda Thakur? Vipin Bihari. How many of you heard of Vipin Bihari? How many of you know about Vipin Bihari? You know. So where do we hear Bhaktivinoda Thakur is getting most of his guidance from? Jagannath Das Babaji. So that was his Shiksha Guru. So there's an example there. But he'd never disrespected Vipin Bihari. So it's there. Okay, does that help? Yes. Dira.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, I hope the question I ask pleases you.
I hope it does too.
That's been lucky, Lisa, recently. So, actually, this morning when I was hearing devotees recant the Guru Vandana translation, the idea that the guru-disciple relationship exists from this life to the next, janme janme prabhu se. So, that really made me think that as you were leading us through the class, that is it really my decision? You know, how much of that do I have control over? And this is just what I have been thinking about the entire time.
Well, if you're sincere, Krishna will lead you. It says that when you're looking for a spiritual master, you look for Krishna first. I want to find God. So then God shows you, here's Guru. So if you recognize that. So it could be your first life with that spiritual master, or it could be continuation. You don't know. In some cases it's one, or in some cases it's the other. But even if it's this life is the first one, if you come back again, then it's janme janme. It's the same one. But he manifests himself in different forms in order to do the service of reclaiming the disciples. That's why it says that if the disciple does not go back to Godhead, the spiritual master has to come back and reclaim his disciple. So someone asked Prabhupada that. Prabhupada, is it true that the disciple doesn't go back to Godhead, the spiritual master has to come back and save him? Yes. Prabhupada said, yes, but go back in this life. Don't give your spiritual master any extra trouble. That's true. So that's there. But that's his service to Krishna. But if you become fallen and you reject your spiritual master, then the contract may have been broken. But if you're following and somehow you don't make it, then that contract is janme janme, like that. Huh. Back door? You... well, I think the back door is locked. Go in through the front door. Don't try any back doors, or don't try to climb in through the window either. Or don't come down the chimney and think you're Santa Claus. Just go in through the front door. The front door is the easy way, and it's the way that's always open. The back door may be locked sometimes. Mercy is there, but don't take advantage. Any other questions? Somehow I feel there's another question somewhere. Was it there? Okay. I knew there was another question somewhere.
This is kind of related to his comment. Like Prabhupada said, when he made a statement that you have to you have to be like 100% Krishna conscious or something like this, go back to Godhead. And then the disciples were like, we can't, you know, they were saying we can't be this. And he said 70%, then he said 50% or something.
Yeah.
And then he said, just hold on to my dhoti and I'll take you back. And so this, I took it that this just means like follow my instructions and
do your best to follow the instructions. Because at the time of death, even though you are not completely purified, if you sincerely tried, Krishna may just wipe away whatever impurities are left and then take you back. So that's why sincerity is the success and not so much qualification. The qualification is your sincere effort, that's, or your enthusiasm like that. Yeah, and that's a good point. But don't take advantage and think that, you know, I can just do 50% and I'll get the other 50 later by mercy. That's cheating. Arjuna was on the chariot. Krishna told him to fight, but Krishna could have dispensed with everybody on the battlefield himself. He wants his disciple to make the efforts, and then he empowers him with his mercy. So it's mercy that comes by way of sincere effort. You have to try. It's not like this idea that it's by faith you may, it's not by works, it's by faith. Your faith has to be, your faith has to be in action. You have to show your faith by what you do and by what you say. Oh, he understands my heart. Let me see the heart in action. That's the whole thing, yeah. Okay, I think that's it. Yes. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Gaur Premanande, Hari Hari Bo. Thank you. Again, the program tonight is at 317 Edgewood Drive, Wheeling. Starts at about 6:30, 7 o'clock.
There's a boga downstairs.